Thank you very much, and it's wonderful to be here. Our plan tonight is to talk about how scholars now think about Jefferson, and particularly on the question of race, and we'll draw from our book, but range widely from it. And then we hope to go on to assess and discuss with you the current state of Jefferson's reputation out there in the world, and explore some of the ways in which our Jefferson and their Jefferson, and I'm not saying that I'm not identifying with the American people, but it's sometimes hard these days, and then move on to an assessment, perhaps more broadly, of history and memory and how we think and rethink race today. And we don't have to stick with Jefferson then. He's a springboard for us. Annette particularly has played a leading role at the Harvard Law School in an issue about how we remember or try to erase slavery. And this is the great challenge for us right now of how we remember and what we forget and what we can learn and take from the past. I think a simple way to put it is this is the era of fake news, alternative universes. Is there some solid grounding that historians and proper historical understanding can provide us in this era? That's a question, and I hope we can talk about it, and we look forward to hearing from you. So without further ado, the first order of business is to sell our, no, I was gonna say sell our book, and that does, we're not leaving until they're all sold, however. the first order of business is to talk a little bit about Jefferson, race, and slavery, and a nice way to begin is to ask ourselves and to explain to you why we chose the title of our book and how that might provide a way of getting into the problems of race and slavery, because what our agenda was in writing this book was to put Jefferson together, the different bits of Jefferson, the Jefferson who wrote the Declaration, with the Jefferson who was the loving grandfather, with the Jefferson who owned human beings. Are they the same person? Do we call him schizoid? Or the fashionable thing to do is simply call him a hypocrite so that we can divide him and take the parts that we like. And we thought that wasn't the way forward. He has been, as Jonathan said, an enormously controversial figure. There are many Jeffersons out there in the national imaginary. Can we construct, out of the best available evidence, a Jefferson who seems right for his times? And then what does he say to us, metaphorically speaking, once we've put him back together again? So, Annette, I could go on for the next couple hours, but that's not the way we usually do this.
How about...
Well, I mean, the idea was we'd sort of gotten tired or weary of this idea of Jefferson who doesn't talk, parts with these compartmentalized Jefferson with parts that don't speak to one another, who was sort of not communicating, not really whole. And he's such a big topic. Duma Malone did 6 volumes worth of a biography of Jefferson and left a lot of stuff out, even doing that. And then we went to an era of Jefferson and slavery, Jefferson and the press, Jefferson. And that was the way of doing it. And so this notion of putting back together comes from the sense that he had been separated out and seemed a strange character in lots of ways, and someone who was not really approachable, not human, not someone who actually you could understand why did he become the person that he did. I mean, reading about him in recent years, you think, how did he have such influence? How did he manage to command such loyalty? He was president, and then he had acolytes, people who were loyal to him from the time that he left and up until we get to John Quincy Adams, and then even Jackson, who you know Jefferson wasn't overly fond of, considered himself to be a Jeffersonian. So we've never had, again, that kind of political influence from one person over that number of years. And so the person that is being described, he was totally... It's inexplicable as to why people followed him, why he was an attractive figure to people. And so that's what we wanted to do. And people have asked us about the title, Most Blessed of the Patriarchs, Thomas Jefferson and the Empire of the Imagination. If you'll notice, Most Blessed of the Patriarchs is in quotes. We had to fight about that.
Very controversial issue.
It's a controversial issue. My editor said, "You don't put quotes on the cover of books." I just could not have people think that we were calling
him.
Because
then there'd have to be a footnote on the first.
Yeah, footnote, exactly, exactly. I didn't want people thinking that we were calling him Most Blessed of the Patriarchs. That is how he described himself in a letter to Angelica Schuyler, whom everybody knows now because of the musical Hamilton. There's no night about the founders that is safe without a mention of Hamilton, of the musical. And I don't mean that in a pejorative sense. I love it.
He did it.
I know he did that. I know, but he mentioned it, but I have to bring it back up. But everybody, when we started writing this book, we had no idea that anybody would know who she was. And now, because there wasn't any reason for anybody to know who she was. And then the musical comes along, and then she's one of the Schuyler sisters, so everybody gets who she is. But so Jefferson is writing to her in 1793. He has lost the battle for Washington's favor in the cabinet, and he's going back to Monticello. He's picking up his marbles and going home. And he writes to her, and he's telling her about his life, what he's going to do, that I'm leaving the government. Of course, he doesn't mention why he's leaving. He doesn't mention that her brother-in-law was the source of all the angst and the reason that he was departing the cabinet because of their battles during the time of the Washington administration. And he says to her that he's talking about his daughters. He says, "I have one daughter who's married, and I have another, and if she comes to live near me, I will consider myself as blessed as the most blessed of the patriarchs." And so he's talking also, and it's another famous line that he talks about, "I have my fields to form," and then he talks about watching for the happiness of those who labor for mine, that is to say, enslaved people. And that's the title of a book by our friend Cinder Stanton, "Those Who Labor for My Happiness," and Jefferson's attitude about slavery. So putting these things together, a person who is considered to be the apostle of liberty, an avatar of freedom, the devotee of the French Revolution, who was seen as a Jacobin, seen as a revolutionary, sort of out there by people during his time period, is talking about himself, describing himself as a patriarch. And later, a couple of years later, he describes himself as living like an antediluvian patriarch in Monticello, among my family, my children, and on my farms. And so you think about a patriarch, you think about something right. Religious, something a thousand, you know, ancient. It's an ancient thing. And to pair that with this person who's an Enlightenment figure, what is going on with this? And so we thought that that would be an interesting thing to explore, thinking about Jefferson, how he saw himself. We think about patriarchy, Peter says it's gone. Well, it's not gone. The patriarchy's not gone.
Well, where is it?
No, it's not gone. The patriarchy's there. No. We think of it as something that's bad.
Yeah. No, that's an important point. And I think one way to begin in trying to put Jefferson back together again is to recognize the fractures or divisions he proclaimed himself in his own life. And one was family and domesticity, home, and the nasty world of politics. Mm-hmm. That is a distinction that he keeps telling us, "Oh, I can't tell you how I long to be home." And when he gets home, of course, all his political friends show up, and he never gets to spend time in the bosom of his family mm-hmm. with his beloved daughter or daughters when they're both alive and mm-hmm. his grandchildren. Instead, he's a political animal, only he has constructed an idea of himself as a private self. In fact, the word self is really important for our understanding of him. In many ways, the shock of recognition with Jefferson, and it's related to the shock of repulsion, is we're into ourselves too. In fact, we brought it to its ultimate limits of our, we're so obsessed with ourselves. And well, I don't know about you, but I am. No, that idea that you might describe as the truly autonomous and sovereign self, and I recommend strongly to you to enjoy it while you can, before you become just a bunch of monetizable data bits, which is on the horizon. I'm sure the American Academy is going to work on that. But this is the frightening prospect. How do you have consenting citizens when we no longer exist? Anyway, to get back to our topic, the idea of patriarchy says that there's something really important, not necessarily about the reality of what's happening at Monticello, but how Jefferson imagines it, how he thinks about it. Mm-hmm. And that striking use of the word happiness that Annette just recited to us, looking out for the happiness, this is the kind of happiness he imagines those people who are dependent on him. They labor for him, but they are within his patriarchal domain. He will care for them, and can you imagine it? He thinks he can make them happy. This is the guy who tells us that you pursue happiness, mm-hmm. that this dynamic quest for some ever-receding, imagined perfect state, that kind of neurotic excitement that defines all our lives are used to before we retired. So it's that notion of the patriarchal domain, the division between public and private. We wanted to get into Jefferson's house, metaphorically speaking, into his private life, not because we wanted to live there, but in order to get a new perspective mm-hmm. on what Jefferson thought about the world beyond his house. Mm-hmm.
And how he thinks that this notion of making people happy, this is something that grates on us, obviously, the benevolent, because he clearly sees himself as a benevolent patriarch. And that is something that's hard for us to wrap our minds around, modern people to wrap our minds around. We see, and I'm not justifying this, but we see the oppression of it. He sees himself with responsibilities. Of course, what that does is that takes responsibilities, it takes power away from other people. And no matter how nice you think you are to being people, and how reasonable you think you are, to remove agency from them, to remove their own power to pursue their own mm-hmm. happiness, or to do their kinds of, their own understanding of their role in the world, is the thing that is the tragedy of slavery. It's the tragedy when we think about slavery, enslavement. It's the problem we think of women, Jefferson and women, all those kinds of things. We've been looking at things from the perspective of the people whom Jefferson is acting upon, and that's very, very important to do. But we thought that it might be a time, at least for a book, to come back and to take him seriously, in the sense, we don't believe every single thing that he says, but to take him seriously, take him on his own terms. What is it that he thinks he's doing in all of this? And if you do that, I think you get a better sense of what other people at the time were seeing, the things that people saw in him that made him an attractive figure, a figure worth following, a person that people mm-hmm. trusted to sort of remake American society into a particular image. So the idea was to look at his letters. And there's so many, as we said, Jefferson and other people's interpretations of him, but to start with the letters, with the church letter and others, letters to his family, letters between members of his family to try to get a picture of who he really was, and to reconstruct that, to talk about the importance of, and to sort of do this in a thematic way, to talk about his home, talk about Virginia, all of the things, starting out, all of the things that made him who he was, who influenced him, and made him this person who thought that he could be an individual in the world, a person who could actually act in the world.
And what would give Jefferson that idea about himself in the first place? And I think this is the unattractive reality that we have to grapple with. Why would somebody in a monarchical world where all men are created unequal, where Anglo-Americans had been subjects of King George III, how could they imagine that they could govern themselves? You know, we just take that for granted, and we universalize it, as we think Jefferson did. We say, well, okay, then we just all of a sudden say, let's have a new country, let's declare independence. But I think it's almost commonsensical to suggest that there has to be a sense of power, a sense of responsibility, a sense of agency, and that comes to people who own their own property, who have a civic independence, who can see themselves as makers, of people who can change the world, who can do things. In other words, to some extent, Jefferson gets his sense of the power of the citizen and the power of citizens collectively by the real power he exercises in his household.
Yes, and that he had from the time that he was a young man. I mean, he was born into at the highest level of society. His father was more of a self-made man, but his mother's family was an old family in Virginia.
Right.
He's the eldest son. When that mattered at the time. He was well-educated, the best type of education that could be given. He didn't go to England. He didn't, you know, travel as a young man to England, but he had a good education in Virginia. He was an intelligent person. He was tall at a time when that was important. And he was white, he was male, and he owned other people. Mm-hmm. So in a sense, you get this person, obviously, who has this idea of about what an individual can do from somebody who had a life that was unlike what ordinary people had. And so he sort of extrapolates this notion of power that, you know, really only somebody who had had that kind of privilege could take his own understanding of what could be done and extrapolates that across the common man, so to speak, the common white man.
Yeah, that's an important point, that extrapolation, and mm-hmm. that's the democratic vision. And one perverse way that I know Jim Kloppenberg will hate, you could say that democracy is based on the universalizing aristocracy, mm-hmm. that sense of being somebody. Mm-hmm. And with a vast continent before us, as Jefferson likes to say in his first inaugural address, well, why can't everybody have a household economy? Why can't all the patriarchs, why can't every man, I mean, of course, white man, why can't they all not be like me? That's absurd. Mm-hmm. But be farmers. Mm-hmm. In fact, farmers would be better than planters. He understands that the existence of slavery is an imminent contradiction, as we might say today. He's discomfited by it. He doesn't lose sleep because of it, mm-hmm. because he does feel that at this moment in his place and time, he has great responsibilities to exercise. Mm-hmm. So there is a great hopefulness in Jefferson. He is a progressive, but one of the reasons he's progressive is he thinks that future generations will move beyond the kinds of conditions that exist in planters Virginia right now. Mm-hmm. And one of the nice ways to get into the problem of race and slavery with Jefferson is to talk a little bit about how he imagines that could happen. How could we get beyond the existence of widespread ownership of human beings in Virginia, mm-hmm. with 40% of the population mm-hmm. enslaved at the time of independence, a larger, even a majority in South Carolina. How could we make that next step? What would happen? Why would the young people be able to do something we can't do right now? So,
well, he believed in progress. He believed that things were going to get better and better and better. That's difficult for us to imagine. I should speak for myself, but
we could have a vote on this. This is a democracy. Who believes in progress?
Who's going to get better?
Yeah,
better.
Okay. Nobody said yes.
Nobody said yes.
there was one.
The one person who believes in it. No, he actually thought that things would get better and better and better. He, again, that word extrapolates, he thought of the world in terms of science, of what he had seen of science, scientific advancements. People's minds were open. Things changed. That's why it was so important to have separation of church and state. Very, very concerned about the influence of religion, of organized religion upon people, and how that kept people back. It kept people believing superstitions, as he would call them. The notion that there would be progress, and it was his generation of people had a revolution, had created a country, and the next generation, it was to them to carry the ball forward. Now, that is unsatisfactory to us. It's unsatisfactory to me, because you always want people, if you think something is right, you want them to be working towards that. But he actually did believe that it was for the next generation to advance things. And he thought that would be what would happen.
And he had a plan. And he provided that plan. He spelled it out in Notes in the State of Virginia. And he repeated it mm-hmm. several times mm-hmm. throughout.
Emancipation and expatriation.
This solution is to take the problem of slavery and to see that enslaved people have been denied any civic existence, to recognize the injustice of that, how do you solve the problem? Well, emancipation, obviously, slavery is a contradiction in terms for somebody who believes in civic equality. How do you get to the next stage? Emancipation, but they can't be freed in America and become Americans. For Jefferson, that boundary between the races, between the white nation, the owners, the masters, and the enslaved captive nation, that was a belligerent frontier, one that had been policed by the institution of slavery. You needed to abolish slavery, then that frontier disappears, but the two peoples are still there. The only solution is expatriation, or what came to be known as colonization, a favorite panacea of right-minded white politicians up until the Civil War.
We talked about this today, interestingly enough, in my class about this, the people. Who are the people? How, after you have a constitution and you talk about the people constituting a people, do African Americans, do black people belong in the people? And part of his understanding and his answer to that and others' answers was, no, they couldn't be, because number one, slavery had destroyed or would destroy any black person's the possibility of loving the country. How do you love a country? How do you love a place where you have been treated the way you have been treated? White people, how can you believe that people who have been so degraded are equal to you? We will never give up our prejudices. That's what he basically says. And there will be a state of war. Well, he thought that there was a state of war to begin with slavery. He accepted the Lockean notion of slavery as a state of war, and that this would continue after it was over, and we would have unending conflict. We would have a war. And we often, and I always say that people laugh at that and it seems horrific, but the truth is we've had sort of a war, a cold war, a hot war. If you think about after the end of slavery, you think of lynching, you think of Jim Crow, you think of, you know, police suppression, police of people in urban areas. It hasn't been easy. And we like to think we're beyond all of that, but we really aren't beyond it. And one of the things we were saying today in class is that the difficulty, Jefferson's real problem is he wrote stuff down. And he's actually thinking about these things and thinking, I mean, this gets, when he's called a visionary, he's a visionary in a good way, but the vision is often not a good one, is not one that we think is palatable, but he's really seriously thinking about how do you incorporate African Americans into a community. If the nation is a compilation of a family, to communities, up to the national government, how can you be equal citizens if you cannot be in families to one another? How do you say that we're equal, but we can't marry each other, we can't have children together? And of course that, well, we can talk about all that, but that's a taboo. That's a sort of serious family formation is a problem. And he did not think that there could be such a thing as a first class or a second class citizenship. And that's kind of what we've ended up with. I mean, we've ended with a republic that has tiers of citizenship. And for him, it was, you know, you're either citizen or you're not. And black people are not going to be citizens here. They need to be in a country where they can be full citizens, because it's not going to happen here.
Well, take the hierarchical old world that Jefferson turns against. This is the new world. It's based on hierarchy. If you were a Federalist, if you were somebody like, oh, I won't say John Adams, that's not fair. If you were a Federalist, you're very comfortable with the fact of social inequality. Now, John Adams is a good small D Democrat. He's not going to say anybody should be deprived of the vote. But he would say that aristocracy is natural. He did say it. He said that there would always be an elite. They would always exercise power. Now, if you see the world in those terms, and those are realistic terms, you say, there's a place at the bottom for you. And that's not the usual American promise, but it does mean that you could be part of the thing, and you can imagine an underclass, and then maybe even in the long term, imagine a gradual rising up. Maybe through education, maybe through some conservative, gradual process that wouldn't disrupt things. That's one of the things about Jefferson, and I think it's, I'm going to quarrel with you a little bit, and it always livens things up, that he shouldn't have written things down. And I ask you, where would we be without those
things?
Come on, it's all about us.
The perils of a written record. Yeah. In very many contexts, Supreme Court justices, all of them, you know, it's saying things makes people think you really, really, really are committed to them, but it also gives your inner thoughts. But of course, he should have written them down, or we wouldn't be sitting here,
well,
right?
Well, I want to throw something else out. He writes stuff down that can be, in fact, has to be read in two different ways.
Yeah.
And that is, take his strongest argument for democracy, one that political theorists who don't know much history get very excited about today. And it's his notion of the Ward Republic. Mm-hmm. And his elaboration of this idea in 1816, he writes a series of letters that draws on his experience and his aspirations. And he says, let's imagine a federal system that just doesn't begin with the states. It begins with these little village republics. He has New England envy. He wishes that Virginia were not made of these oligarchical counties in which there was no real democratic government. Let's start with the ward, but slow up, just a minute. Maybe let's begin with the farm or the plantation. And the citizen, the patriarch, that's the first stage in his democratic vision. And go all the way, as Annette suggested, to the county, from the village to the county, to the state, to the union. And I got one for you, folks, the whole world. You could build up. This is the strongest statement, the inspirational statement of his democracy. Nobody knows better how to govern his own farm or plantation than the farmer or the planter. Is that commonsensical, my fellow Americans? And what am I saying when I say that? I'm saying, don't mess with my slaves. Sorry to be so offensive, and I just have to get loud at least once in every one of these performances.
It's the patriarch. Well, that's the patriarch.
Right.
I mean, that's it. That's the patriarch. That's
they're loud!
The patriarch, they're loud. Well, that's the
idea. That's all I've got now.
That's the idea of control and mastery over your own domain.
Yeah.
And that's the thing that, I mean, that's the problem that we have with Jefferson today. I mean, it's interesting talking about the sort of changing fortunes. I mean, who would have ever thought that we would be here? And I did a freshman seminar this year, and it was Hamilton and Jefferson. And, you know, 12 students, I think I had two people who were, you could call Jeffersonian. It was all Hamilton. We're all Hamiltonians now. And, you know, that's sort of an interesting turn of events that's happened here.
Jefferson is black now.
I had a friend of mine who took her daughter to see Hamilton. And then afterwards was reading a book, a child's book, about Madison Hemings and slavery and so forth. And then she looked up at her mother and she said, Thomas Jefferson was white?
Who knew?
Who knew? There's a whole generation of people, young. She's about 7, 8, or 9, you know, who think, oh, okay, yeah. So we're in a different environment now, explaining all these kinds of things. But this notion of the sort of end result of his ideas that are anathema in ways to our understanding about racial, you know, a notion of a multiracial society, make him a hard sell, even though there are so many other aspects of his, you know, of his life, of his theories that are in fact useful.
Well, that's why I insisted on the double reading of Jefferson. I got so excited when I got loud, and I apologize for that, because I was in effect telling you that his democratic theory is simply a cover for slavery, and that's a reductive and stupid reading. There's a lot more to it, and there's a lot more to everything Jefferson has to tell us. And I think that's the challenge, and this is maybe a nice time to segue into Jefferson's standing today. Mm-hmm. We had a conversation, and we have lots of conversations at Monticello, and Annette and I go down there often to give them really good advice, and it's about how should Monticello now engage with the problem of race as well as slavery in the wake of what happened in my old hometown last August, when the idea that Jefferson is the racist because he insisted on a distinction between black and white, and he did not envision a multiracial or a biracial republic. So maybe he's the problem, and maybe it's time to put him down yet again. Mm-hmm. How do we deal with that? How do we deal with that notion that Jefferson stands for something we need to repudiate? Mm-hmm. And that's a logical conclusion. I can understand it. We can understand it. But it's not going to get us anywhere. Jefferson is a richer resource than mm-hmm. that. Mm-hmm. We can't reduce him to that. But I think that, in a very briefly, is the moment we are now in. We know Jefferson is a complicated character. I should say complicated for us. Mm-hmm. That is the reality. It's hard to read him.
It's definitely how we're seeing him.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I'd written something about this to try to flesh mm-hmm. out the very thing that you're saying here, is this notion of how you have this person who is so much a part of the American story that you really can't write him out of it. You know, it might be a comfortable thing to do, but then it really is like these stories about, you know, the Long March, when Mao, you could tell who was out of favor or in favor by whether or not they got airbrushed out of the picture, you know, and then come back in, and then he's there, then he's not. But he can't be that because there's just so many aspects. He had his hand in so many aspects of the founding that you have to deal with it. And for me, it's like dealing with the country itself, in a way, the kinds of contradictions of the country itself. There are the strong points, the weak points. There's the issue of race. Then there's the issue of religion. There's all kinds of things that you just have to grapple with. And putting it away mm-hmm. isn't going to solve the problem. It's not going to make it go away, that it never happened. And that's the real challenge. And I think it's difficult for people, some people, to do that today. It's either he has to be a hero, he has to be the devil, or he has to be God. And at Monticello, they're really trying to walk the line there to try to find the right balance, because people are coming and asking questions that they might not have asked 10 or 15 years ago. It's a different story that's being told. There are more voices, more people who are interested in trying to make sense of all of this. So the project really was, I mean, basically it was a chance for us to work together.
Sell a lot of books.
To work together and to try to explicate the life of somebody who we think is indispensable in a way to understanding the country and understanding ourselves.
I think just about every idea that we think is crucial in our modern day political toolbox has a Jeffersonian genealogy, and we have to know what's packed into those ideas, like democracy. But I'll throw another idea out, and that's the idea about rights. How does rights thinking emerge in the United States? It emerges through the strong voice of Jefferson and Jeffersonians. Mm-hmm. It's based on a conception of liberty, which we now see racialized, and we understand its historical context, and we reject it. But the modern idea of liberty, the modern idea of rights, the modern idea of democracy, all draw on Jefferson. And in thinking about those ideas, we need to think about that background, what's packed into those ideas. We need to be aware of how we both differ from Jefferson and how we are indebted to him. And that's another way of saying we have to come to grips with the fact that we are Americans.
Yep. So with that,
we turn it over to you.